I see your angels and all these streets of gold that lead to you. If touching love is touching God, no wonder I'm in heaven when I'm holding you. Simple as a song, a melody repeating in this heart. I don't know when the chorus came, where I heard it first, but when it started. I won't be holding my breath for chariots. I'm not just waiting for skies to part. You've been my glimpse of kingdom right from the start. And you got me touching heaven. Ooh, 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 ooh. Got me touching heaven. Ooh, 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 ooh.
So tell me what you're dreaming. Tell me what it is. Your dream come true. I don't need a map to find a hidden treasure there. Ain't no hiding you.
Breath for chariots. I'm not just waiting for skies to part. You've been my glimpse of kingdom right from the start. And you got me touching heaven. Ooh, 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 ooh. Got me touching heaven. Touching heaven, and you're my hallelujah. You're my hallelujah. Yes, you are.
You're my
Yay. All right. Well, hey, welcome, Mountain Online. It's so good to be together, to be here with you, Anthony.
Yes,
and
it is.
To everyone, with everyone watching online today. Hey, it's summertime. I mean, I guess it's kind of been summertime, but school is about to be out.
Mm-hmm.
And it's kind of like a cicada summer too, right?
Yeah.
We have a lot going on here at Mountain. Hey, let us know where you're watching from today in the chat. Always fun to hear. Maybe you're already on a little bit of a summer vacation. Who knows? But let us know. So coming up this summer, we have a couple things that we wanted to share this morning, but the first is Welcome to Mountain, and that's happening this weekend on Sunday, June 13th. It's happening at two of our campuses, at the Aberdeen campus and the Mountain Road campus. So if you're watching online today, you can still make time to head over there. Hop in your car if you're watching locally, and you can still go ahead and catch a Welcome to Mountain at 1 o'clock. It starts. But what else do we got going on?
Yeah, for the month of July, like every Tuesday, every campus will have an experience of what church was and is. We'll ask questions of how was church and why do we meet and what is the experience? So we're going to meet and do worship and prayer and scripture and celebrate just to really experience church in a real, real way. You don't want to miss that.
All right. And for students this summer, we have Mix and Move. And Mix is for our middle schoolers, so going into 6th, 7th, and 8th grade.
Right.
And Move is for our high school students. And these both of these experiences are a full 5-day experience. And new this year, a little bit different, is that it's going to be local. It's going to be right here at the Mountain Road campus. And it's going to be at a lower cost this year. So it's just going to be a great time for students to be together, to be in God's Word, to play games, and just to be in community together, and the opportunity for them to bring friends too. So definitely register. Registration is still open, and check out the website for that. But one more special thing is coming up next weekend. Tell us about it.
Yes, next weekend, Father's Day weekend, as we celebrate that, we want to celebrate in a special way of following Jesus and his example of baptism. We are calling it a baptism splash. I know we have isolated for almost a year. We haven't seen each other. We haven't seen community really getting baptized. But this coming weekend, we are looking to follow this example of baptism. I still remember my experience when I say, Jesus, I need you. I need new life. I need forgiveness. I need someone who can really change me afresh. And in this obedience of baptism, I can never forget. And you have that opportunity to say yes to Jesus as Lord and Savior in front of many people. Come on out on a baptism splash.
Yeah, and baptism splashes will be happening at every campus, and it'll be happening right here online. So maybe you're watching online, you're thinking, hey, I want to get baptized, but maybe not at a large gathering yet.
Yes.
Or maybe you have family or friends who are out of state who would like to witness your baptism. If that's you, definitely sign up on our website or just register so you can be baptized right here during the online service, and it'll air online during our worship services next weekend. So awesome time to celebrate. I think we got it all in. Are we ready
to
worship?
I think so, yes.
Mark,
let's worship.
We ready?
Yeah, guys, we're ready.
All right.
All right.
Well, hey, Mountain Online. Something we like to say around here is welcome home. Whether you're new around here, whether you've been around Mountain for a long time, we hope you feel at home. I'm sorry, guys.
All glory forever. breaking free. Hear the song of the redeemed. He is moving, he is moving, he's alive. So take this freedom, take this love. Can you feel it rising up? He is here, he is here, he's alive.
Thank you.
In the New Testament, we read about Jesus and his disciples and how he walked with them, ate with them, taught them how to live a missional life. And in the process of being with them, he every now and then tell them, "I will die and rise up in the third day." And they didn't understand why. He's popular, he's teaching, he's healing. Why is he saying he's gonna die one day? But it's after he died and rose, they understood the magnitude of his sacrifice. They understood that through his sacrificial death, we have forgiveness of our sin. And all our wrongs are wiped out because of his death. Not only that, his love is united with us in a relationship that can never be broken. And it's just so awesome to have Jesus as a friend. And above all that, in 2 Peter 1:3 says, he has given us divine power to help us walk godly lives. Just imagine, we have divine power to help us in every moment, in every situation, whatever experience you're going through. Jesus has given you his life and the Holy Spirit to help us walk and live like he did. So in this time of communion, take it and believe and bring and appropriate all those divine gifts and attributes that God has given us through Jesus. Let us pray. Jesus, we thank you for your sacrificial death and for the life that you've given us to live in us and with us everywhere we are. I pray right now you visit that home and connect with them and encourage them and let them know that you are there with them. For it's in your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. This is the moment we reflect about generosity. Generosity, your generosity, is the fuel that drives the church to mission. And we know church is not a building. Church is people. Church is you and me. And generosity gives us and drives us to go to our neighborhood, where we walk, where we live, in our families, and love like Jesus loved, and forgive, and heal, and save, and bless, and rescue, and reconcile, and do what Jesus asks us to do. And that's what generosity does. And we want to say, if this is your first time here, we say no obligation to give. We give because we see, and we experience, and we see change when mission is happening. You can give online, and we are so grateful if it's your first time to be here with us. Let us pray. Father, you're generous. You gave us Jesus, and you give us all the blessings so that we can go out here and bless our families, our neighborhood, our country, and the whole world. We commit all the gifts today and pray you multiply it, so that your work and your love will be experienced all over in the whole world. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. You've been coming maybe online and you've seen hosts asking them questions and answering your questions. We want to have this opportunity right now to meet one of the hosts as she shares her story. Check this video out.
A typical weekend serving, we're getting our coffee ready. We like to preview a service before we actually serve. We pray together. We get a digital brief that tells us what's going to happen. And then when that music starts, we start. I started online. That's what brought me into my next step and to connect with the church. I always went to church as a child, and then I stopped going. I found myself searching, though, and I just started watching church online first, very, very casually, and watching the online chat. I didn't join right away, and I didn't let anybody know who I was. Week by week, I would come back, and then I started putting my name in, and I would get a greeting. It was a sense of belonging that I think I was looking for. And then I signed up for a Welcome to Mountain. After the session, we were baptized in the church. I wanted to serve. I wanted to be part of the church, not just attend. And online was where I did it. Now the table's turned. I've got the keyboard, and I'm answering. I'm answering those folks that are coming through to attend online. And I felt so blessed. I felt like part of their life and then part of their faith journey. We say hello, welcome, And then we start seeing your welcomes come in. And then we pray for each other when we get prayer requests in. We want the Lord to guide us and guide our words through everything. And each time it lifts us to respond to what is needed by the community. I would like to turn that around somehow. And somebody who was like me and felt alone and didn't have the joy that comes from knowing God and knowing God with others. Because when you're doing it alone, it's not the same as it is when you find sisters and brothers in Christ.
Serving is one of the most effective ways that we can show people that they matter to us and they matter to God. And as someone who's been participating in Mountain Online, maybe you've been wondering, how can I serve God? How can God use me from where I'm participating from right here online? And the good news is that He can as a member of the online chat host team. So if you're feeling led to maybe get some more information or serving in this way, go ahead and scan the QR code on your screen or click that button in the chat, and someone from the online team would love to reach out to you and share more details about ways that you can serve online.
You know, I grew up in a great home with an amazing family and awesome parents, and they knew God. They really did. They were the real deal, and we went to church all the time. It was a part of our life. I went to youth group and camp and stuff like that. When I was 12 years old at a camp called Pine Haven, I just knew, and I walked the aisle, and I said yes to Jesus, and they baptized me in a cold, muddy lake. And I've never really appreciated that moment more than I do these days. But you know, when I was in high school, my world started to get bigger. I started to kind of think critically, you know. I started to study the humanities and the sciences, and I began to ask questions. Questions like, you know, is this whole Christianity thing even real? Like, do I know that if I wasn't born into this family, whether I would believe any of this at all? And I allowed myself to kind of ask some questions that I was kind of afraid to ask before then. It wasn't like a full-blown crisis of faith, but I began to wrestle with some doubts. As I wrestled with those doubts, it made me really hungry for the truth, and I wanted to investigate the claims of Christianity. I wanted to kind of know what was real because I had to choose a life path, you know? And that led me down this road of just kind of studying things and reading things. I was a junior in high school, and I went back to summer camp. In fact, the same one that I'd given my life to Christ at. And one night, they had this fireside chat thing, and there was this college professor that was deeply respected. I respected him. And he was speaking. And I'll never forget kind of what happened that night. Here he was, this smart guy, but he believed in God. He was a Christ follower, and I wanted to know why. And he actually talked about it that night. And he said, you know, there's lots of mysteries to the Christian faith. There's lots of things I don't understand. He said, there are things that I couldn't convince you of if you're determined not to believe them. He said, but you know what? The whole thing, said, comes down to one important thing. He said, it all rests on something that happened in history, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. He said that, and I listened in, and what is he talking about? And he said, you know, because if that one thing is real, if that happened, God came to earth in flesh and lived and died and rose again, that changes everything. And whatever other questions or tensions or unanswered things you have in your head, you can learn to deal with that. And it would just make the most sense in the world that I would trust that kind of a God who would love me and have that much power. And when he said that, and he went on to explain how he had experienced the risen Christ in his own life and how science and all this stuff was helpful for the resurrection, something in my head and my heart clicked into place. And I, in that moment, I knew this is what I'm giving my life to, and I'm sure of it. And faith was rekindled in me, and I'll never forget it. I told my friend Rich right after that, I said, I think I believe in the resurrection again, and I'm ready to do this with my life. And here it was, just a few feet away from where I had given my life to Christ in baptism years earlier. I'd kind of come full circle. And ever since then, I've been trying my best to follow Jesus, and it's not been always easy. And there's been some hard stuff, but it's changed so much of who I am. And I think about how different I would be without Christ. I mean, it's like I'm a completely different kind of husband and father. I'm less selfish, I hope. I know, I think I am. It's certainly changed my career path, as you all know, but it's also just changed who I am in so many ways. And you could never convince me today that Jesus isn't real because of everything I've seen in so many lives and in my own life. And I'm absolutely convinced of this also, that it has made all the difference for me. That's my story. So what's your story? What's your God and me story? Because everybody has one, right? Everyone's got a God and me story. What if I told you that God wants to use you to bless other people, and that one of the ways he wants you to do that is by sharing your story? And that didn't have to mean, you know, something super scary or super tense or super combative or awkward or icky or creepy or any of that, but really just the most natural outworking of friendships that God puts in your life, of people you enjoy being with, and in the course of everyday conversation with people you enjoy and pray for and eat with and hang out with, God would open the door for you to do what friends always do, and that is talk about something that's important to you. That's exactly what we're talking about today. You know, we're in this series. Welcome, everyone, to the final installment of this series we're calling Blessed, B-L-E-S-S. And if you're just joining us online, welcome wherever you are in the world. And a big shout out to everyone who's in one of our campuses today. Big shout out to the people at our brand new Aberdeen campus. Shout out to our friends at the Edgewood campus and at the Abingdon campus, at Mountain Road campus, wherever you are. Glad you're with us. It's fun to see more and more people coming in person every week. Glad to have you with us. Next week, I want to tell you, is going to be off the charts cool. It's Father's Day, yeah, but I think the highlight is going to be we have a baptism splash plan. We have water at every campus ready to go, because I think that some people are going to have their story really take a big, exciting turn next week as we see many people, I believe, commit their life to Christ, and I'm ready and excited for that. I think God's been at work during the pandemic. So check it out on the website, mountaincc.org. That's where you can sign up or just show up. We don't care if you sign up or not. Just come, and whatever you do, pray this up and get people to listen or to be at one of our campuses next week. You know who they are who need to just hear a word from God. That's all happening next week. Where are we right now? What about this week? Well, here we go. Jesus was asked one time, what's the most important thing? And without skipping a beat, he said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. And then he said, also without missing a beat, love your neighbor as yourself. Love God and love people. How do you do that? How do you love your neighbor? If you're a person with your head screwed on, you ought to be asking that question. How do we do the thing that Jesus says is most important? And God's answer has always been the same. It's bless them. It's how God started this whole thing. Remember Abram back in Genesis chapter 12. Abram, I want you to leave everything you know and love. I want you to go, and I will bless you. Why? So you will be a blessing to others. Not just you, but all the families on the earth will be blessed through you. I can see Abram like, what? You want to bless not just me, but everyone? Yes. How? Through you, Abram. And guess what? God still has the same agenda, to bless everyone you know, especially the people that are far from him. Those are the ones he wants to love into the family the most. How does he want to do it? Same way, by Jesus saying, go. And as you are going, you're leading them into the life that is life in me. As you're going, make disciples. Every day, you're on mission. And so that's what bless is really all about. It's about living our lives, realizing that every day, we're called to love our neighbor by blessing them. And so we're stealing this acronym. It's B-L-E-S-S, BLESS. We got it from the Ferguson Boys, and it's awesome because these are so simple, practical. They're biblical, right out of the life of Jesus. They're memorable, but man, they're not just things in a sermon series. This is meant to anchor down into like who we are. So let's remember what they are, okay? Let's go through them one at a time. Give me a B. What does the B stand for? B is begin with prayer. Right. Makes so much sense. Start right there. Then L stands for listen, because that's the way we care and love for people. E stands for eat. How can we share meals to just develop friendships and enrich our lives with others? And then last week, S is serve, where we humble ourselves and just in tangible ways reflect the love of God for others. And then today, the final S stands for share your story. Share your story. Now, you might have noticed something about these things. B-L-E-S is, those first four are kind of nonverbal, right? Like you don't have to use a lot of words for those things. And nonverbal communication, as we all know, is super, super powerful. Like you can say a lot with just your body language and your face, right? Someone says, oh, I love cats. And you go, ugh. I didn't say anything, but I communicated my opinion, didn't I? Or, you know, a bunch of guys are on the golf course and someone sinks a 20-foot putt for the clinch win and wins all the money, and all the buddies on his team are jumping around the green, high-fiving, slapping him on the butt, because that's what guys do. They didn't say a word, but they communicated a lot. You know, teacher's in class and someone's sitting in the back row and they're slouching and their arms are folded and they're too cool for this school. They're communicating a lot. I was with some friends this week who've lost someone very dear to them. Friends from our church with a death in the family. And when I greeted them, I didn't have a lot of words. We just held each other in a tight embrace and locked eyes. And everything was communicated that needed to. You can also bless people in lots of ways without using any words. You can pray by just calling to mind an image of that friend or neighbor and silently offering it to God. You can listen with your ears, not your mouth, right? You can eat by just being present and physically there with someone. You can serve them with your hands and your feet. But guess what? When we come to this matter of blessing in the way that Jesus did, eventually, my friend, if you want to help them find Jesus, eventually you're going to have to use words. If you want them to know the good news, they're going to have to eventually hear it. Here's the takeaway. If you want to bless your neighbor, Jesus invites you to share your story. All right, Jesus invites you to share your story. The final S in the word bless is the one that sometimes gets left off, guys and gals, because it pushes us out of our comfort zone, honestly, doesn't it? But you can't spell bless with only one S, and you are not going to very likely lead someone to discover the love of God without naming it for them. By just hoping they pick it up by osmosis, there's going to be times when words are necessary. Now, if we're honest, this one's tricky because we can be pretty reluctant, I think, to venture into this territory, to share our stories. There's lots of reasons for that. We've all heard the expression, the cat's got your tongue, right? We know the expression, has the cat got your tongue? And there's debates actually about where that phrase originated. Someone said, well, it comes back actually way back to the old English Navy, where they would whip someone and flog them with a cat of nine tails, a whip. They call it cat of nine tails, and they would be silent for days. Well, why aren't they talking? Well, cat got his tongue. Some say it was back in ancient Egypt, when if you blasphemed or did something like that, they would literally yank your tongue out and feed it to the cats. Why isn't that guy saying anything? Well, literally, the cat got his tongue. Others say it was from medieval periods where witches had these evil cats and the minions around them, whatever. Whatever the case, I think it just pretty much confirms that cats, it's one more piece of evidence that cats aren't as good as dogs. But the other thing it really reminds us of is this, that fear can sometimes keep us from talking. That's what the expression means. When the cat gets your tongue, you sometimes have a story and something you want to say, but it doesn't come out. And I think we identify with that. I know I do sometimes. because we don't want people to think we're weird, or we don't want to be socially offensive or out of place or show bad form or not respectful, or I don't want to offend someone, or I don't want them to think I'm weird, or I don't know if I'll do it right. We have lots of reasons, like the time Peter in the Bible, who really loved Jesus, but he was cornered in that courtyard and the girl asked him about Jesus and he was like, Jesus who? He denied even knowing him three times. And then the rooster crowed, and I think we can all identify with that, whereas sometimes maybe you felt a little inner nudge from God, like your stomach starts moving, like, oh, this is maybe a moment I'm supposed to share something or say something about my story or point to God, but you freeze and you don't, and like when the rooster crowed, you feel like you missed it and you're horrible. But you know that same guy, Peter, when he eventually had an opportunity to be forgiven and meet the risen Jesus, he was completely changed. He was a completely different dude. In fact, we meet him over in the book of Acts, and he's this confident, bold leader of this fledgling Jesus movement at that point. They dragged Peter and John one day in front of this really brutal kind of intimidating council in Jerusalem. They drag them over there and they threaten them. Look at what happens in Acts chapter 4. Here's what it says. It says, they called the apostles back in and commanded them, never again speak or teach in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John replied, do you think God wants us to obey you rather than him? We cannot stop telling about everything we have seen and heard. This is the same guy, the same sort of Jesus who, I don't know what you're talking about, who just a little while later is like, you can put me in jail, do whatever you want. I can't not talk about this. And you know what? I think every one of us has a little bit of one of those versions of Peter in us or the other, don't we? We have sort of the, I just let the moment go by and I, oh shoot, missed it. Peter, we have a little of that in us. We also have the capacity to be like, oh, this is such a good story. I can't not help it, and I'm not going to worry about what you think. I wonder which one you're like right now. I want to encourage you today. I want to encourage you to find your tongue, to share not everything, but your story. And I can tell you this, most of us are never going to be put in a position like Peter and John were that day, where you're physically threatened, you know. But I tell you, here is what God is calling you to do, and that is to love your neighbor and to care about people who are far from God, and to care enough about your friends and family and people you live and work and play with that you will, when the time is right, because you've developed natural relationships, you'll be ready to just share what Jesus means to you. And that's it. And then you leave all the results up to God. In the warmth of the light of friendship, it's the most natural thing in the world to talk about your life with God. Now, I think this is so difficult for a lot of us that we need to talk a little more about some of the reasons for our reluctance. Let's break them down a little bit. And I'm not trying to argue with anyone or convince you, but these are things that again, from Dave and John Ferguson that are so helpful. I wanted to share them with you. Number one, I think a reason that a lot of us are super reluctant is we say this, I just don't have what it takes. Because we imagine in our head that sharing your story is reserved for super religious types, right? Or it's like people who have the Bible like memorized forward and backward, or what if they get me into a debate or they ask me, you know, some question, I don't know, did Adam have a belly button? You know, or I was like, what if I just freak out or I mess up or something like this? And you know, This fear of not having all the answers is very real for us. You know, but I love this. I love Matthew 24. One time they cornered Jesus and said, when's the end times? When is the Father going to restore everything to Israel? And you know what he says? He says, I don't know. And I love that. You know, I love it so much because if Jesus can say, I don't know, so can I, and so can you, and it's totally okay. I've been asked so many things by unbelievers, and they'll think, oh, you're a pastor, well, what about this? And I'm like, I don't know. You know, let me think about that, or let me ask around, or maybe I'll do some reading and get back to you. You know, and it's totally okay, because the beauty is about Jesus and what he's done in my life, not me knowing every answer to the questions. You're not gonna know every answer to challenging questions. You're not going to have all of that. And that's okay, because listen, here's what you do have. You have the Spirit of God with you. When Jesus' disciples were sent out, they're like, oh no, we're all freaked out. And here's what Jesus said, Matthew 10, he says, don't worry about how to respond or what to say. He says, God will give you the right words at the right time. Isn't that awesome? He'll do that for you too. He says, it is not for you, it's not even you who will be speaking. It will be the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. I've experienced this so many times. And I've talked to countless people who are like, I don't know what happened there. I was so nervous and afraid, but just kind of like a calm came over and I found a sentence or two that just was like, that was really good. Where'd that come from? I says, I know where it came from. It's the Spirit of God speaking through you. Maybe you don't have what it takes, but if you have Jesus, you've got the Spirit in you, you've got a little story to tell, and you do have exactly what it takes, all right? So there's another big reluctance though that a lot of us have, and that's this one here. When a person says, I don't wanna impose my beliefs on other people. I just don't wanna impose my beliefs on other people. And it's weird because we live in a climate when everyone's like jamming their stuff down everyone's throat, right? On social media and everywhere. But Christians feel this like, yeah, it would be bad form and I don't wanna do that. Or maybe we've seen these Christians who are like always angry or ranting on social media or yelling and ramming the Bible down someone's throat. And if that's what you're afraid of, good. Don't do that. Okay? Don't do that, all right? But that's not what we're called to do. Remember Peter, the one who said, I will share what I have to say about God. You know what else he said? Look at 1 Peter 3, 15 and 16. He says, if someone asks you about your hope as a believer, always be ready to explain it. But, listen, he says this, but do this in a gentle and respectful way. Can I just say to some of my friends, if you're one of these believers who thinks you're helping by ranting and arguing, always trying to win, and you come off judgy and preachy, but you're not doing it in a way that has other people feeling respected because of your gentleness, according to the Bible, you're doing it wrong. Please think about this. This isn't about you being right. This isn't about that at all. This is about the beauty of Jesus and in hoping people are attracted to him. It's a conversation where you're invited to share some of the reasons that your life is different. And I promise you, humbly sharing the difference Jesus has made in your life is not imposing your beliefs on anyone. It's called friendship. That's why I love that quote by D.T. Niles. He says, you know what Christianity is? It's really just one beggar kind of telling another beggar where to find bread. I love that. It's like, don't hog the bread. If you found something good, why wouldn't you want to share that? And if you've truly found forgiveness in Christ, he's changed your eternity, he's changed your outlook, he's given you hope in trouble, and you're going to use some words sometimes so you don't hoard the bread. Listen to what Paul wrote to the Romans. He said, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. That promise for Abraham can happen today, where all the peoples of the earth can be blessed. How? Through Jesus. They just got to call on the name of the Lord Jesus. Now, listen though, listen to what he says in verse 14. He goes on to say, but how can they call on him to save them unless they believe in him? Great question. He says, oh, but think about this. How can they believe in him if they've never actually heard about him? Oh yeah, that's a good point. And then he says, and how can they hear about him unless someone tells them? Let's read that last sentence again, but this time I'd like you to swap out that word someone with your name. Okay, how can they hear about him unless Ben tells them? Unless, how, maybe you can swap another name out for the word they. How can Marlene hear about him unless Susan tells her? How can Michael hear about Jesus unless Simone tells him? Friends, this is our calling. everybody's hungry for truth, and for everyone's hungry for love. Everyone's hungry for peace and hope. And Jesus says, I am that living bread that you're hungry for. So be ready to share your story about how some of the hungers that everyone has have been fed for you by Jesus. You know, there's one last reluctance I want to mention, and that is that sometimes people say things like, you know what, it just, this whole thing makes me feel uncomfortable. Sharing my faith makes me feel so uncomfortable. And I get it. Some of us are new to it, or we get nervous around trying to put words out there, or what if I, you know, they shoot me? I mean, we get all these kinds of bad things in our head, right? So, but can I just cut to the chase here? Are you really going to let those feelings of you being nervous and uncomfortable stop you from sharing words that could change someone's life and their family and their kids and their kids' kids and their entire eternity? I mean, let's put it in stark terms. I mean, being nervous is not always a good reason not to do something. I mean, people register for nursing school and take driver's tests and start businesses even though they're nervous, and often they're glad they did. When I met Carla, I was so nervous I couldn't find any words to even say, but I finally found a way to say, could I call you sometime? And I'm glad I did, because there are some things that even though we're really nervous and uncomfortable about them, we figure out that the potential benefit and gain is so much bigger than the fear we feel around the nervousness that we go ahead and do it. And this, my friends, is one of those. For people who are followers of Jesus who went to a cross on our behalf, we can find our tongue. Now remember, when we talk about sharing our story, it doesn't have to be super complicated. I think we make this harder than it needs to be. Let's just kind of bring this down and let's keep it simple, all right? I want to show you something. One day Jesus met a guy who had a life-changing experience with Jesus, for sure, and he had an amazing story as a result. It's told about in John chapter 9. Look at verse 1. It simply says in verse 1, Jesus was walking along, and he saw a man who had been blind from birth. So we don't know much about the guy. We don't know his name. We'd learn later that he was also a beggar. So he's very poor, and he's a blind guy who's never seen a sunrise, never seen a sunset, never seen his mother's face. There he is, begging for bread every day. Jesus comes by and does something really weird. In the text, it says that Jesus bent down and he got some dirt in his hand, then he spit in it, and he made a little mud pie, and he rubs it all over the guy's face. And then he says, now go wash it off. It's just weird. I don't know. If it was my story, I'd probably want to leave that part out about, you know, someone putting spit-filled mud pies in my face. But it's part of the story, and so that's what the guy does. He does, and look what happens in verse 7. So the man went and washed and came back seeing. Like, wait, what? The guy who sat there every day is now up and around going, hey, I recognize that voice. Is that? I didn't know your nose was so big, Fred. You know, he can see. It's amazing. It's a miracle. So I wasn't blind from birth, but I've worn glasses since 1975. And at first, then I started getting these glasses. They're like, you can see far away, you can see close up, but not far away. Well, then later when I got older, it changed and I couldn't see up close either. I had to change my prescription. And then they had to change it again when I got astigmatism. I go to the doc a little while ago, and you know what she says? She says, you've got cataracts. I'm like, cataracts? That's for like old people, isn't it? And they're like, she didn't say anything. So yeah, I got cataracts. She says, good news, we can take those lenses out. We'll put new ones in and you won't be fuzzy anymore. And they did that a couple weeks ago, and I'm like 20/20 now. It's like, it's amazing. It's like I can see again. And trust me, I'm like everywhere I go, people are like, Ben, where's your glasses? I'm like, let me tell you. And I'm telling them all about it. I'm like into the story. It's like, I'm telling you, I can see this now and all that stuff. And I don't wear glasses anymore, blah, blah, blah. You know, and it's so interesting. And I can tell you, if I have that tiny little story, you can imagine this guy had a big story to tell. That's the kind of difference Jesus can make. And so what I love is when they press him, what happened to you? Look what he says in verse 11. He says, the man they call Jesus made mud and spread it over my eyes and told me, go to the pool of Siloam and wash yourself. So I went and washed, and now I can see. And I'm sure they're just like, oh, that makes perfect sense. No, they don't understand it any more than he does or why, but he just tells his experience and the difference Jesus made. That's all it is. They keep pressing him, and I love this part. Verse 25, they're like, come on, what's the real story? And he says, look, I don't know. I was blind, now I can see. Jesus did it. That's it. That's all he knows to say. And he doesn't argue with them. He doesn't give them any scripture verses. He doesn't get any theology lessons going. He just says, I was blind, now I can see. Friends, that's all any of us are called to do, is to think a little bit about what would my life be like without God? And to name that, describe the difference that Jesus makes, so that in a conversation, you'll be ready to share it with gentleness and respect with a friend you've been eating or praying for or eating with or listening to. Now, I want to encourage you, get very practical here. I want to encourage you this week to share your story, to think about how your story would look, and to share it. I'll give you a simple framework to do that, okay? We're going to get real practical in the time that remains. There's three parts to every story, okay? Check it out. Number one is my life before Jesus, right? The second part of everyone's story is my life since I met Jesus. My life before I met Jesus, my life since I met Jesus. And the third part of everyone's story is what's my life like now, okay? It's, what's the exact wording on it? My life since I met Jesus. That's it. So, my life before Jesus, I was a blind beggar. How I met Jesus, I don't know, he came up and put mud in my eye. And number three, my life since I met Jesus, I can see. And this pattern is exactly the story. I want to recommend to you all a TV series called The Chosen. I really love it. It's a creative and faithful telling of the life of Jesus done in a very moving way, and you can check it out on the app or YouTube or, you know, wherever you can find it. It's called The Chosen. Season one, Nicodemus is there, and he tries to cast out demons out of a tormented woman who is filled with demons and is abused by men as a prostitute and Satan in so many ways, and he's unsuccessful, but later he sees her. Her name is Mary Magdalene. He sees her in the marketplace whole and beautiful again. And he's so struck with it. Watch this clip from The Chosen.
He called me Mary. He said, I am his. I am redeemed.
And it was so. Who did this?
I don't know his name. And even if I did, I could not tell you.
Why not?
His time for men to know has not yet come.
His time for men? He performs miracles and seeks no credit? What does he look like? Is he a member of Sanhedrin? Would you at least know him if you saw him again?
I don't know why I am sharing this with you. I don't understand it myself. But here is what I can tell you. I was one way, and now I am completely different. And the thing that happened in between was him. So yes, I will know him for the rest of my life.
I love that. You know, I was one way, and now I'm another. And the thing that happened in between was him. That's the threefold pattern of everyone's story. It's the threefold pattern. If you're a believer in Jesus, it's your story. Everyone's got a story, and it doesn't have to be dramatic like Mary's. Mine isn't even dramatic. Doesn't have to be amazing, but if it has Jesus in it, it's got a how I was before Jesus, how I met him, and what my life is like now. It's got those components. So I'm dead serious about this. I'm going to give us a minute right now to work on this, okay? You're going to leave here in a minute, you know, this time of ours being together with some clarity. I hope you open your spirit now to this because you have a story. Let's think about how yours would go, okay? Let's do some work on this because you can seriously populate those three buckets with some thoughts from your life, your story, so you could be ready to tell this story in 3 minutes or 30 minutes or 3 hours, whatever. But it starts like this, my life before Jesus, remember? my life before Jesus. Tell about that. And if you grew up in church, tell about what it was like before you got really serious with Jesus. What was your life like? Maybe there was struggle or loneliness or addiction or stuff like that. Maybe you were on a dead-end path or you were chasing, you know, sex or whatever it was. Or maybe it was just I was consumed with work. I only thought of myself. Or life was great. I thought life was great, and I never even thought about God. Whatever it is, tell that. Second piece, remember how I met Jesus. Maybe he put mud in your eye, but I doubt it. Maybe it's something like, I don't know, what led you to start thinking about God or be more open to it? Was it a friend who invited you? Was it a tough time you went through? Was it someone who shared their story with you? My marriage fell apart. I got a DUI. My mother died. It was cancer in our family. It was something I saw in the war. One time a guy said to me, my life I thought was going great. I was making money and was successful, but I'm sitting there watching a movie with my kids and I see this scene in a movie and it reminded me how empty my life was. What was it for you that led you to finally meet Jesus where you took steps, you said yes, and you got baptized and began to belong to the family? And then third, my life since I met Jesus. What would you put there? Like, think about the differences in you because of Jesus. Like, what does it enable you to think and be differently? What impact has God's presence in your life made through the bad times? Be honest, be real, don't sugarcoat this. You know, don't say, oh, then I met Jesus and everything is great. Be honest about the hard times and your failures along the way. And how thankful you are, like I am, that when I screw up royally, I can go back to the amazing grace of God. What's your life like now? Keep it real, keep it short, keep it simple. Write it down maybe, type it out, share it with someone. Small groups, every small group should be doing this together and sharing it this next week together, all right? You can do this. And as Dave says, don't sanitize or romanticize it, just tell your authentic story, okay? I got to tell you about Jen. Jen was a self-described atheist at one point in her life, but today she's a committed follower of Christ. And if you asked her what made the difference, she would tell you it was not the philosophical and intellectual arguments along the way. She would tell you how a close friend of hers shared her story with her. She shared the story of how Jesus had radically changed her life, and Jen just wrestled with it. She says, I didn't know what to do with that. It just kind of sat inside of her, tugging at her. She would say her friend's story lived in her heart and her mind for years. And when Jen finally started wrestling with the idea that there was a God that loved her, man, it was her friend's story of what God had done in her life that made all the difference. It's the power of a story and a life. And you know that time I was telling you about when I heard that college professor say those profound words that impacted me, that convicted me? What I didn't tell you is that that professor was my father. And his words were convicting and wise, but what moved me was his life, his story, and the meals we had shared and the testimony of the difference I could see. His story was his life, and that's how good stories are. So your story, whether you think it's simple or boring or amazing or ridiculous, doesn't matter. It's not really your story. It's God's story, and he says, I want you to share it like a beggar who's found bread. Point people to the living bread. So here's your challenge. Super practical. This is going to get fun now. Here's your challenge. This week, share your story in 15 seconds or less. You can do this. Three parts, three sentences is all it takes. Share your story in 15 seconds or less. Here's a video to cue you up. Check it out.
Hey, guys.
Oh, boy.
Does that sound good?
I feel pretty good. I was sharing my story because I think there's just a lot of value in just sharing that experience with other people.
I have a hard time expressing myself sometimes, so it was just finding the right words.
I'm feeling okay sharing it. Like I said, the story's not over yet. The story is still being written.
I was sat down for like maybe like an hour to try to like put it all together and actually like remember and process and pray. So there was a time in my life where I was very selfish and prideful. And Jesus helped me get away from that. And through Jesus, I've been able to spread the good word and serve others and find purpose in my own life, spreading the word of God and spreading the kingdom. Jesus saved me. So.
There was a time in my life when I didn't realize Jesus was in control and I thought I was the driver. But then I was forgiven by Jesus and chose to follow him. Now I realize Jesus is the GPS of my life and I'm just simply following his instructions.
There was a time in my life when I felt unfulfilled and lost. But because Jesus forgave me and I chose to follow him, I now live a life filled with purpose and joy.
So there was a time in my life when I was indulging in too much drink, too much alcohol. It was having a negative impact on a variety of things. Through a confluence of events that came together, I became convicted of both the need and also the desire to change. But I realized I couldn't do it on my own. So I went to the cross and I asked Christ for his forgiveness and I asked Christ for him to take it from me, to take the desire from me. And he did. And here we are 15 years later. And in those last years, I've not had a drink, nor have I had a desire for a drink. So that's my story. What's your story?
So, what's your story? Here's your challenge this week. Share your story in 15 seconds, okay? Practice with your family, write it down, time yourself. You can do this. Share your story. Be bold, be willing, be strong, be willing to go outside your comfort zone. Be like Jeremiah who said, it's like a fire in my bones. I gotta do this. I wanna do this. Wake up every day this week remembering the sermon series is over, but it's gonna live on through me because you're gonna put your feet on the floor and remembering I have been given a mission to bless people. And do it this week by sharing your story. Think about it, guys and gals. God has used someone to pray for you and to bless you and to love you right into the family of God. Think about that part of your story, and now it's your turn to return the favor.
Grandma used to pray out loud by your bed every night. To me it sounded like a mumbling, like she was out of her mind. She said, boy, this kind of praying is what saved my life. You ought to try it sometimes. And now I know she was right. She was talking to Jesus. She was talking to Jesus. She'd been talking to Jesus for all of her life. Mama used to drag me to church Sunday mornings and Wednesday nights, khaki pants and a polo shirt. Boy, I put up a fight. She said, son, one day you'll thank me for having God in your life. And yeah, I know she was right. And yeah, my mama was right. Cause now I'm talking to Jesus. I was talking to Jesus. She got me talking to Jesus. My mama was right, cause now I'm talking to Jesus. Yeah, I love talking to Jesus, and I'll be talking to Jesus for the rest of my life. What a friend we have in Jesus. What a friend we have in Jesus.
What a friend we have in Jesus. Oh, what a friend we have in Jesus. What a friend we have in Jesus. What a friend we have in Jesus. Oh,
I've got three of my own now, trying to raise them up. My oldest is 15, and I remember what that was like. Trying to deal with the drama, trying to figure out the questions in life. And I've been looking for a way to show how to make it all right. And then he walks in my room while I was saying my prayers the other night. Come back later, I can tell you've got a lot on your mind. I said it's not an interruption, you couldn't have picked a better time. Cause I was just talking to Jesus, come over and give it a try. We started talking to Jesus. Bad time to stop. It don't have to sound pretty. Just tell them what's on your heart. Cause it's not a religion, it's more like a friendship. Just talk to your father like you are his kid. Just start talking to Jesus. Just start talking to Jesus. You can talk to Jesus whenever you like. Just start talking to Jesus. Just start talking to Jesus. Just keep talking to Jesus. The rest of your life.
What a friend we have in Jesus. What a friend we have in Jesus. What a friend we have in Jesus. Whoa.
If you're someone who's blessed enough that you know how to talk to Jesus and you have a relationship with him, it's because someone talked to Jesus about you and they loved you and they blessed you and they helped you find your way home. And I just want to call out to everyone who's a believer right now, and I want to call out to everyone who longs to have their life count for something super meaningful. I invite you to make a pledge and a promise with me right now. Because this sermon series, we're going to wrap it up and we're going to move on to something else. I'm just praying with all my heart that this stuff we're talking about, B-L-E-S-S, will be something so real, it'll anchor down into my heart and your heart and stay with us, so we would live like Jesus lived, because our world needs it so badly. So will you make a promise with me that we won't be perfect, but that we will pledge to try to be a blessing? I'm going to ask you to take this seriously right now. We're going to close out this way. I'm going to ask you to stand, in fact, at any of our campuses, stand. Rise to your feet if you would. And if you're at home, I'm watching you, stand up with us, will you? If you're driving your car, we'll let you sit, okay? But we want you to stand because it's a way of coming before God and saying, God, I'm serious now, and here's our pledge. A prayer that would go like this: God, with your help, I will begin with prayer like Jesus did. Show me the people you want me to lift up and pray for and open doors and just help me to change my heart and change theirs. I'll begin with prayer. And God, with your help, I will try to do a better job of listening, using my ears more than my mouth, to ask good questions and to just convey to people that they have dignity and worth and just love them through listening. And say with me, God, I'm gonna do my best to eat meals intentionally and share some food with friends and family and just to, like Jesus did, build relationships that go deep and see what you might do with that. And God, with your help, I will try to serve and humble myself and show your love in tangible ways by serving. And God, with your help, I'll try to be ready with gentleness and respect through whatever doors you're going to open for me to share my story, even if it's in 15 seconds. Today, I'm ready. Like one beggar helping another know where to find bread. Amen. My friend, if you've been blessed, it's for one reason: so you can be a blessing. So go bless.
Amen. Well, friends, we know that each time that we gather together, God is at work and He is moving in our midst. And as God calls to us, it's so important that we respond with our whole heart. And today, maybe that's you. Maybe you're ready to turn your heart toward God, to say yes to Jesus, to be baptized. If that's you, I encourage you to tell someone right now, and you can do that by clicking that request prayer button in the chat. Someone will be there to talk with you, to pray with you directly right now. And friends, if you're new here, just wanted to say welcome. Thanks for worshiping with us today. Be sure to let us know that you are here by scanning that QR code on your screen or clicking that new here button in the chat. That'll let somebody from our team know that you are here worshiping with us today, so we can send you a free gift, a gift that just says thanks so much for worshiping with us today. And as we close out our Blessed series, each week we have been sharing an inspirational graphic that you can download to your phone. I encourage you to scan the QR code on your screen right now for that final graphic. Maybe save that to your phone, use it as your lock screen, share it with family, friends on social media. Use it this week to reflect and to keep today's message in your heart, to pray over it. All right, well, before we go, I want to encourage you with this verse from 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 15. But keep the Lord Christ holy in your hearts. Always be ready to answer everyone who asks you to explain the hope you have. All right, well, stay safe and healthy, friends. We look forward to seeing everyone next weekend as we celebrate new life in Jesus through the baptism splash. Have a great week.
So I do my thing like there's nobody watching. We don't sweat the money, we got power like Austin.
Yeah, baby.
Stone Cold,
yep.
Steve Austin. People stop and stare whenever, where that's
you're awesome. Tell him love me now, cause later on it could cost him. She said, you think you're all of that, cause you're handsome. I told her, handsome. I know I'm awesome. God made me awesome. I'm not just talking, I'm dynamite.
Okay, okay.
To you from the other side, and yeah, I've been a hell and back, I could've swore I died, and yeah, dodging depression, looking for a message, facing my fears and hoping for a blessing, telling my demons they can get the step, and I was lost, no, I was hiding, I was so divided, chasing after wind, I couldn't hold to find it, trying to get bigger bags, yeah, trying to get what they have, yeah, should've been holding back, didn't know what I had. So let's celebrate, yeah, let's celebrate, oh yeah, we gon' levitate, there'll be better days, yeah, yeah. Let it resonate, throw the stress away, yeah, yeah. Don't waste another day, come on, baby, let's wake up and celebrate, come on.
Celebrate, yeah, I'm celebrating more, ayy. Celebrate, yeah, I'm celebrating more, ayy. Celebrate, yeah, I'm celebrating more, ayy. Celebrate, yeah, I'm celebrating more,
hey. We gotta celebrate, cause like the year's over. We gonna do it good. My dog a year sober. I give online, don't judge me when I pass the church plate. All I want is the cake for my birthday. Yeah. Closing our houses and opening businesses. We went to college and finished it. Did a whole lot with a little bit. Yeah, if we take an L, then we elevate. Don't let your food get cold. Looking at somebody else's.
So let's celebrate, yeah, let's celebrate. Oh, yeah. We gon' levitate, there'll be better days, yeah, yeah. Let it resonate, throw the stress away, yeah, yeah. Don't waste another day, come on, baby, let's wake up and celebrate, come on.
Tell me what it's all for. When you get what you want and you still want more. In the end, you know that life's the reward. So, baby, worry less. And celebrate more. Celebrate, yeah, I'm celebrating. Celebrate, yeah, I'm celebrating more, ayy. Celebrate, yeah, I'm celebrating more, ayy. Celebrate, yeah, I'm celebrating more, ayy.